I lived in rural Kentucky. I live amongst, I used to live amongst tobacco chewing, pickup truck driving, ball cap wearing people, and that was the women. Eighty percent of the people I knew were named Bubba, and the other 20% were named Loretta. And I don't mean Loretta, I mean Loretta, okay? And you can always tell if a redneck and his wife got a good relationship because of the drool of tobacco juice is the same length on both the passenger and driver's side of the door. So, anyway, I live so far out in the woods, I had to go toward town to hunt. You know, I mean, Larry was my cable guy. So, you know, you may have seen me sitting down during praise and worship. It's not because I'm not into praise and worship. It's just that praise and worship is a very thin place for me. And if you have any concept of the spirituality of place, you'll know that most of us have somewhere where if God's going to speak to us, He'll speak to us there. It's called a thin place. Crowder said, you know, heaven and earth come together with a big sloppy kiss. Well, that's a thin place, you know. And one of the best places you can ever be is right where the lips meet, you know, and be right in the middle of the kiss. So for me, that's what praise and worship is. Actually, I believe we come to church for praise and worship, P.S. we get a message. Because when David established tabernacle worship in Jerusalem, you know, he didn't establish 24-hour day preaching or 24-hour day teaching or 24-hour day prophetic conferences or healing meetings or seminars on how to build a successful church. He established 24-hour day praise and worship because he wanted the presence of God in his city. Okay? Now, God respects us when we study. God fills us when we ask. God provides when we need. But the truth is, He inhabits the praise that we give Him. And so if we're going to be a place where God makes His habitation, where He tabernacles with us, we have to be a praising people. And not just exterior praise, but interior praise. That's important. Because there's a lot of times when your exterior doesn't want to praise, so you got to let your heart do it for you. Amen. So, anyway, I have this tendency to sit during praise and worship, and God lately has been giving me stuff that I've been calling, for lack of a better term, a prophetic exhortation. Now, exhortation is preaching that is just supposed to lift you up. You know, it's not about getting people to the altar. It's not about driving out demons. It's not about, a four-point plan to, you know, lead, you know, to bus mainland China to Sunday school. It's, or casting out demons with a light fly rod. I'm not explaining the joke, so if you don't keep up. Anyway, oh, by the way, I do this a lot, okay? But it's my daughters, okay? They go, Dad, I'm not saying, I'm just saying. Okay, so now in the family, we don't even have to say it. I just look at April and she goes, you know. And I realize I've gone way overboard. Anyway, I'm sorry. I keep popping the mic. I don't mean to do that. I apologize. Where's Barney? Has he still got the headphones on? I'm sorry, man. I know I'm blowing snot right out your ears. I'm really sorry, man. Oh, you know, I got that going thing on. Anyway, so this morning, God not only gave me some things, but He sent me back to some things I've already written. And I'm a little tenuous about this because some of this stuff I wrote never expecting anybody to see it. So, but the Lord wants me to share this, and I'm gonna. Because at the end of the day, the only real accolade that I really desire to receive is, well done, good and faithful servant. And none of you guys can say that to me, okay? Not that I don't love you, and I love your praise, and I love your accolades, and friendship, and kisses, and hugs, and all that stuff. But At the end of the day, I do this for an audience of one. Yeah. And this is what he's requested. So I'm going to give it to him, and you guys can listen. How about that? Okay? All right. So this is a poem that I wrote in April in the year 1992. It was, as the Queen would say, for me, annus horribilis. It was, some of the things we'll talk about tonight are some of the difficulties that you go through and how you get through them. And, you know, so I'm not going to go into great detail, but I'll just say it was one of the lowest points I've ever been at. And so I wrote this because I had this conversation with the Lord. I said, I was in a place where, now you have to understand, in my heyday, my average crowd, I preached 5 days a week. I did 25 shows a month. And I did that for 20 years. Okay? And my average weekly crowd, like on a Monday, a Tuesday, and a Thursday, because I didn't do Wednesdays and Sundays because I didn't want to mess around with local church stuff, because my deal is, you know, the bottom line of it all is local church. The rest of it's all fine, but the bottom line is local church, okay? I mean, the rest of it is great, you know, but that's just gravy on the taters, okay? I mean, the real deal is local church. So I never, ever did shows that would conflict with local church or cause people not to show up. But my average weekly crowd was between 2,000 and 5,000. And then on weekends, it was between 10,000 and 15,000 on a Saturday night and a Friday night. So now, because of some things that happened, and if you ever look me up on the web, you'll find it. Of course, it's all been 20 years ago. Nobody ever updates anything, and you think I did it last week, but, you know, hello. Anyway, so, I mean, even if it was all true, I've had time to get over it, and it wasn't, so I didn't really have to work that hard at it. Anyway, but I was in a place where I'd gone from being universally loved to almost universally hated. I went from a place where everybody said good things about me, Si, to a place where almost everybody had something ugly to say about me. I went from a place where I was flying around the country with my own pilot and my own entourage and stuff, going to big shows and doing all of that. And within a year's time, I'm standing in the supermarket. I got a coupon for baked beans and a coupon for toilet paper and only enough money to buy one or the other. And that'll get your attention. Thank you very much. And the answer is, you buy the beans. And then you have them put them in paper bags. Because plastic will not do it. Anyway, so here I am in this mess, and this is what I wrote. I said, here? Because I remember there's 10 people sitting there. And I told the Lord I was going to continue to minister no matter what. And he said, okay, let's see if you mean that. So now instead of 10,000, it's 10. 10. Awoka. Okay. I said, here? And he said, yes. And I said, are you sure? And he said, yes. I said, why? He said, because. And I said, but. And he said, never mind. I said, I'm scared. He said, I know. I said, I don't understand. He said, you don't have to. I said, can I be sure? And he said, yes. And I said, how? And he said, because I said so. And I said, but? And he said, never mind. I said, well, he said, yes. I said, all right, Lord. He said, I'm proud of you. I said, thank you, Abba. He said, you're welcome, my son. I said, are you sure? And he said, buddy, it's me, remember? And I said, okay, sorry. He said, no sweat, it's all good. Amen. The only thing you're sure of is that God's got a plan. And at the end of the day, life can be confusing, it can be painful, it can be absolutely contrary to everything you think and feel. But if you have a sense that God knows what's going on, even if you don't, then you can reach a place of peace. And the goal of life is to find a way to not only get to heaven, but also to overcome while you're here. And the way you overcome in Jesus' name in this life is to find that peace that passes understanding. And the only way you're ever going to find it is if you realize God has a plan. Well, you know, none of it makes sense to me. Wow, I guess God couldn't do it unless it made sense to you. I mean, really? I mean, God's got to check everything out with you, right? And if he doesn't do something that you don't understand, he couldn't possibly do that because, well, you just don't understand it. I mean, whatever happened to my thoughts are not your thoughts, my ways are not your ways. Dude, we're never going to understand it, okay? I spent my life trying to get it. You know, we don't get it. We don't understand it. It's irrational, illogical. You're never going to figure it out. That's fine. You're not supposed to. Actually, if you can figure it out, it's probably not God. I mean, really, do you want to worship something that's small enough to fit in your imagination? Oh, my God. You know, I don't even know how to get across Paris. You know what I'm saying? Gee whiz, that's not what I want to worship. I want somebody that's got this view, not this view. You know? Woo-hoo! I need that. Anyway, so that's good. I like that. I just thought that one up. But the Lord is large and he's in charge. And we have to start understanding that we are what he says we are, not what we think we are or what we've been forced to believe we are. And so we need to kind of start rethinking things a bit, because the Bible says that's the way we become transformed. We become transformed by the renewing of our minds, okay? See, we get saved when we got the Spirit living inside of us, and the Spirit is trying as hard as it can to manifest in our flesh, but we got this thing in the way. It's called your brain, okay? And that's why, well, I can't do that because I don't explain it. That's not practical. I can't give. You don't understand. That doesn't make any sense to me. How can you stand there and tell me that I need to give my tithe when I'm not making enough right now to pay my bills? And it's probably because you're not giving your tithe. But anyway, that's a whole different series of things, and we'll get into that. You see, I knew it. No preacher can go for 5 minutes without talking about money. I just hate it to hear you preachers beg for money. Okay. Don't make us beg. I mean, come in, throw your wallet at us, and we'll never say anything about it again. Hallelujah. Not a problem. Anyway. So I found this really, really great thing. And I thought it was just really, really nice. It was written a couple hundred years ago. It's called A Litany of the Person. And this is how the Lord sees me. I see myself as sometimes very weak and sometimes strong at inappropriate times. How many of you know you can be strong at inappropriate times? How many of you know that you can be so strong you can look God straight in the face and say, it's okay, I got this? Really? I was talking to a guy that was doing 3 life terms for murder in prison. And he said, I don't need God. I've got this under control. And I said, really? How's that working for you, you know? I'm leaving here. I'm going to Applebee's. I'm going to have me a Bourbon Street steak, and you're going to the cafeteria and have stale bread and green bologna. You know. So we got to start looking at, well, this is what God says. Because of Christ's redemption, I'm a new creature, and a creature of infinite worth. I am deeply loved. I am completely forgiven. I am fully pleasing. I am totally accepted by God. I am absolutely complete in Christ. When my personal performance reflects my new identity in Christ, that reflection is dynamically unique. There has never been another person like me in the history of mankind, nor will there ever be. God has made me an original, one of a kind, really somebody. Significance comes from realizing who you are in God. Sorry, I brushed my teeth, now I can't talk. I'm not sure why that is. I just know that when I wash my hair, it gets frizzy too. There could be a connection, you know? Well, anyway, I don't want to think about that too much because, well, frankly, my mind's not a neighborhood I'm comfortable going in by myself. Anyhow, so we need to understand the plan. We need to understand there is a plan, but we don't need to understand the plan. But what we need to understand is that because of the plan, that makes us who we really are. See, that's part of the mystery, who we really are. You know, we hear what we are from the TV. We hear what we are from our parents. We hear what we are from our friends. We hear what we are from adverts. We hear what we are from, you know, studies and psychologists and sociologists. But the truth is, what we are is a secret. And only God knows. Yes, sir. Isn't that cool? Yeah, He has your secret name written on a diamond, and He keeps it. And He keeps it safe. And when you get to heaven, the first thing you're going to get is the diamond. And you're going to look at it, see who you really are, and you're going to go, oh my goodness. God has one tattoo. People don't know this, but God has one tattoo. One tattoo. It's right across the palm of His hand. And you know what it is? It's your name. Your real name. You get me? And if you look at it, you'll just see your name. But then if you look at it, you'll just see your name. And if you look at it, you'll just see your name. Because the truth is, He's just your Jesus at a point. Yeah, we share Him, but He's a personal God. So the tattoo is just yours. And the diamond is just for you. Yowza. I mean, this is the good stuff right here, okay? This is the stuff that's supposed to be giving you goosebumps. And if it isn't, you need more caffeine. So anyway, we got to understand this. We got to understand that this is what God has written down someplace. And this is only man's way of trying to say it. And I'm pretty sure that it falls way short of the mark, okay? I think someplace we are the actual source of every rainbow in the universe. I think that's us. I think that just comes straight out of who we are. Woohoo! Hallelujah, I like that. You have to get, I get excited and I shout, but my shout comes out, woo, because apparently I have the Tigger anointing. Well, you know the Tigger anointing? Most wonderful thing about Tiggers is Tiggers is wonderful things. Their heads are made out of rubber. Their bottoms are made out of springs. They're rouncy, trouncy, roly-poly, fun, 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 fun. Most wonderful thing about Tiggers is I'm the only one. Woohoo! You know, which is much better than the Eeyore anointing, which is what a lot of Christians have. Amen? Oh, no, it's not for me. I'm just going to stand in the corner till Jesus comes. Bless Kanga. Bless Piglet. Bless Pooh. Pooh? Really? I have 16 grandchildren. I know what poo is. And if they made a bear out of it, I don't think I'd want to play with it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, anyway. These are the things I think of, so now you know why I'm afraid to go into my own brain. Hallelujah. People say, goodness gracious, that guy is weird. Understand, I've already been helped. You wouldn't have liked me before at all. Trust me on that. Hallelujah. But God is so good, and He gives us these glimpses of eternity all the time. And of course, being us, the kind of people that would kill the goose so that we could have all the golden eggs all at once, we can't be patient and just walk it out because somehow, some way, we've got to get a handle on it because really in the depths of our hearts, the thing that causes us most problems is our desire for control. And the thing is, control is an illusion. There's no such thing as control. Until you can tell me exactly what's going to happen in the next 5 minutes, there's no such thing as control. You know, those guys went to work that morning at the World Trade Center. They thought they were in control. And everything changed in a heartbeat because they weren't. None of us are. You know, your life can, you know, your life can alter at the turn of a wheel, at a missed stop on the roundabout. I mean, dude, there's no such thing as control. There's only one person that's in control. That's the Lord. That's why it's not only a good idea to submit to Him, it's also a wise idea to submit to Him, okay? Because if you know in part and you see in part, but you have somebody that's going to give you the ability to see fully later, why don't you just follow Him now? Because He's already got that one nailed down. I'm just saying. Anyway. This whole thing about being transformed. I love transformation. Don't you love transformation? The whole idea of transformation. I mean, that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. Sorry, I had a moment. And once you've had it done to you, I'm telling you, do you ever see a butterfly trying to crawl back into a cocoon going, man, I miss being a worm, you know? You know, I believe that the chain that God uses to bind us to Him is made out of forgiveness. And I think the hardest thing for us to forgive is us being us. So when we start thinking this way, our lives begin to change. Whatever is of good report. Praise yourself for the things that you do right instead of beating yourself up for the stuff you do wrong. And if you're married to somebody, do the same for them, okay? Because He has a plan for us to do us good, not to harm us, and to give us a future and a hope. Every little thing about you, about you.